but we have to keep moving on. I'm Sarge Green. I'm with the California Water Institute here at Fresno State. And the next panel is discussing that we recognize that changes are going to occur in the San Joaquin Valley, and especially in the water environment, and what solutions that we already talked a little bit about today, what those might look like and what they might instigate. So really what we're going to talk about is the challenges of the solutions that have been suggested, because none of the things that we talked about are going to be easy. And we have an outstanding panel of people who have a lot of experience then in trying to address challenges. We've got a couple all the way up at the state level. Dave Orth and Randy Fiorini. Dave is with the California Water Commission, and Randy's with the Stewardship Council. And then Ashley has recently stepped down as the mayor of Fresno, so she's seen a few challenges in her career so far. And Emmy Cattani is a farmer in Kern County, and you heard the challenges that they face in many respects down there from Eric. So quickly, I'm going to go over their bios just like everybody else did. I'm not going to read the entire thing. You have it in your already in your package, so I'm just going to go over the highlights. Emmy in particular is a fourth-generation farm family in Kern County, and her business includes growing grapes, almonds, and oranges, and she has cattle raising as well in the Tehachapi Mountains. She's also been in the financial business in the past, in the private side, and then she's on a number of boards of conservation organizations, including the Tejon Ranch Conservancy. So she's got a little experience in dealing with the environmental issues associated with farming and cattle ranching. So then next we have Randy Fiorini. Randy's chair of the Delta Stewardship Council, and he's been with the council since 2010. He's also a farmer in the Turlock area. He's got tree fruit and wine grapes. He's been involved in water since 1992, and he was a former director of Turlock Irrigation District, much like Michael is today. And from there, he moved on to become president of a number of prominent organizations, including San Joaquin River Tributaries Group, Authority, the California Farm Water Coalition, and I had the pleasure of serving with Randy on the Association of California Water Agencies, who is president there. And of course, now he's chair of the Delta Stewardship Council. Dave Orth is a member of the California Water Commission, and previously he served as general manager of both Kings River Conservation District and Westlands Water District. He's also worked for California Farm Company, the California Valley Land Company, and he had some positions in the past as a financial analyst in Fresno County. And then next is Ashley. She's now the president of the Central Valley Community Foundation, a charitable foundation serving six of the Valley counties, including Mariposa County, which is not on the Valley floor, but nonetheless inextricably linked with the rest of us. In fact, that was a comment I've heard already, is that we haven't necessarily talked about the upper watershed as part of the problems and part of the solutions for water management in the future in the San Joaquin Valley, and I think we'll address that in the report at some point in time. Nonetheless, she's working with that area, and I think you know that she was the former mayor of Fresno, and before that, she was a colleague here at Fresno State, Fresno State's Office of Community and Economic Development and the Regional Jobs Initiative. I'm going to mix the questions up a little bit. I'm going to do a little different. I'm going to let them go freewheeling on the second question, and I'm going to give a little more construction to the first question, because I think there's some answers that we need from some of these people on some of the very important things that they're already working on. So I'm going to start the first question with Randy. Randy, as chair of the Delta Stewardship Council, what do you believe is the one key issue or most vexing problem that remains as an impediment to attaining the co-equal goals? For those of you who don't know that it is, we've got a goal in the Delta Stewardship area, the legal Delta Plan area, of having both environmental restoration and water supply benefits. And what is the chance then, what's the goal of getting reliable water exports and enhance improved surface water availability to the San Joaquin Valley, and when can we expect resolution?
Well, thank you, Sarge. Sarge has answered the question. The first part of that question is what is the most vexing problem, and then he went on to ask more specifically about water supply reliability, which is one of the co-equal goals that the Delta Stewardship Council has been charged to address. A more reliable water supply for California, and at the same time achieving a healthy, restored ecosystem in the Delta. The options for restoring a healthy ecosystem in the Delta are many. The options for improving water supply reliability, particularly as it relates to conveyance of water from the Delta, is very limited. The Bay Delta Conservation Plan has been an aspiration since 2006 to do a landscape level combination of improving conveyance and expanding habitat acreage in the Delta. That plan was abandoned in 2015 and bifurcated into WaterFix, which is essentially a project that would build two tunnels to convey water through under the Delta, and California Eco Restore, which is a target of 30,000 acres of restored tidal marsh, wetlands, habitat in the Delta. Clearly, for the San Joaquin Valley and in many parts of the valley, fixing the conveyance problem and the ability to move water through the Delta in a way that does not impact negatively the environment is the number one issue. I'll leave it at that, and in the course of the conversation, we can get to more of the details.
Very good. Thank you. I'm going to switch a little bit and go a little more regional and local and ask a question of Ashley. In one of her last duties, she participated in a couple of meetings of the North Kings GSA that was mentioned earlier by David Sayers. And I think she had a grasp and understood what the stake is for cities in implementation of SGMA. But I'd like her to share with us her impression of where the cities are, but not necessarily just the cities in the larger cities, but also I think we've got smaller cities, and then how are they going to deal with the anticipated growth that they have planned in their general plans? What do they need to do to effectively participate in groundwater management?
Well, thank you, Sarge, and good afternoon, everyone. I feel like I owe all of you one big disclaimer before I give you my perspective from being mayor for the last 8 years. When I was called and asked to participate in this panel, I argued for about 20 minutes and I said, are you kidding? Of all of the incredible people that are here that know this issue inside and out, I hardly think I can contribute to anything that needs to be discussed today. And finally, I was persuaded that in fact, you guys wanted to hear from city folk. Is that fair? Okay, so I'm going to tell you from my perspective, having served as mayor, and what I've observed among our neighboring communities, and just my perspective and opinion on how and whether the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act has actually percolated, pardon the pun, into the thoughts and minds and plans and implementation of those plans of the surrounding cities. And let me start by saying, since I'm not with the city of Fresno anymore, I'd like to really praise them, and it won't seem like I'm, you know, complimenting myself, because it's a different group now and a different team that's carrying out really the hard work that has to be done. But for 30 years, the professional staff in the water utility at the city of Fresno had proposed surface water treatment facilities to take better advantage of the access to surface water that the city of Fresno thankfully has. For 25 years, elected officials and senior leadership of the city denied those plans and refused them and kept them from moving forward. Why? Because who wants to be the city manager who tells the mayor, who tells the city council that they have to be on record imposing a tax and raising people's water bills, right? That turns out it's not a really fun thing to do. And it is particularly looked down upon here in the greater Fresno area. So for 25 years, those plans sat shelved until finally my colleagues on the city council, our amazing leadership of our water utility, our city manager, we knew that we had to get this done for the future of our kids, our grandkids, and our great-grandkids. And when people start looking at you and say, oh, you're from the city of Fresno, where that cone of depression is. How many of you have heard about the cone of depression? You know, you start taking it personally as mayor. Like, you've created this, you know, psychological effect by sucking the groundwater up underneath you, you know, for city water use, 283 municipal wells in the city of Fresno. And so it was clear to us that we had to provide leadership and that we had to take responsibility and actually do what it took to get off of our groundwater, to provide for future generations of Fresnans, but also to contribute to a healthier groundwater basin, knowing that ag all around us is really what we all depend on. We want to see a healthy, thriving ag community. When I think of the future of Fresno, I envision a robust agricultural economy. And so it was a way we could contribute to what is going to be needed in the long run for ag. So we took it on. And the reason why it took us about 5 years to ultimately get things done is we went through, we had, of course, the council voted to approve after many, many months and years of study and citizen input and that sort of thing. We then had a lot of opposition from residents, understandably. Their water bills were doubling. That was a big concern. We had a petition to overturn the council's actions. The city council then decided to sue the petitioners. That was super fun. And went through a fairly lengthy arm wrestle in court and that sort of thing, ultimately settled that lawsuit, but committed to restarting the 218 process and doing a supercharged 218 process to really engage the public in even broader ways than are required by the law, and to then once again take up the matter to the council for a vote. After the 282, we had tens of thousands of petitions returned, which some of you may appreciate that in previous exercises when bills weren't being increased too much, we'd have maybe a couple of hundred of our 100,000 plus account holders in the city of Fresno, or probably about 190,000 account holders. We had 25,000-30,000 ballots returned. Okay, so this was not a popular thing to do. And to the great credit of my colleagues on the city council, they approved the rates anyway. We are now under construction with and deploying about $600 million over a five-year period of time, mostly for surface water treatment, as well as for recharge and recycled water. So all of that was happening. And frankly, really, we didn't fully know what was going on with SGMA until after the fact. And then that bill passed. And then in early 2015, when we were right in the middle of this big arm wrestle, we all went, oh my gosh, we have no choice. 3 years ago when we started this, we thought we had a choice. We could do status quo groundwater pumping, but wouldn't it be better if we got off our groundwater? But when Sigma passed, we realized, holy cow, this is not an option anymore. The city of Fresno to contribute to the groundwater health for everybody in this area, we have to get off our groundwater. That is a very long background for you, but I want you to know. So the city of Fresno has been all up in the front of this issue in this particular part of the valley. And as we're dealing with this, weeping, gnashing of teeth, you know, tens of thousands of people saying we were crazy, all this kind of stuff, I'm lifting my head up occasionally and asking the question, what's going on in our neighboring communities? What do you mean such and such local jurisdiction is proposing an enormous development on groundwater? How can they do this? Don't they know about Sigma? Don't they know that, I mean, literally the big collision that, you know, I think for a couple decades, it's just been this polite deal that ag people don't really charge at city people and say, you stop what you're doing because it's really hurting us. And city people, frankly, are pretty clueless as to how what they are doing is impacting ag, because no one ever said we had to all of a sudden pay attention to what we were sharing, which is our aquifer. But that train wreck happened. And now we are inextricably and regulatorily linked. So cities and the larger cities on the valley floor, not just the small rural communities that you could argue, well, you know, that you can understand why they wouldn't know, they're not causing that great big of an impact, but larger communities other than Fresno, I am concerned, do not fully appreciate what's going on with this legislation. So it is an urgent matter. And, you know, in reading the report, it's clear that municipal use is not the big user of groundwater, and yet every dot matters. And, you know, for the city of Fresno, we knew we had to contribute our part. And if we had access to surface water, we better be using it because we have to see that aquifer replenished. So I believe in the next couple of years, you'll start hearing this, like, kind of silent shriek across the League of California Cities, across CSAC. I mean, you'll start, you guys are on this already, you'll start hearing in the municipal local government arena, people will start waking up and realizing what's going on, and it will dramatically affect the single family home building industry, and it will dramatically affect how cities have always planned on what they consider economic growth, which is this expanding their boundaries, and I believe that that is about to change. So I will pause with that. Thank you for allowing me to be somewhat dramatic about all of that, but... No.
We appreciate it.
I got to keep it interesting.
I'm going to go to Dave next. And as I mentioned, Dave is a member of the California Water Commission, and they're charged with allocating the Proposition 1 bond funds to public benefit portions of water storage projects. And, of course, we're all aware of some of the larger projects, whether it's Ray Shasta, Sites Reservoir, Los Vaqueros, or in our own neighborhood down here in the Valley area, Temperance Flat. And that's a pretty good size storage project. And if it gets built, it could potentially assist with groundwater recharge by holding more water than current. But having said that, most of the storage is below ground and the overliers own the property. So the question for Dave is, how do we get better connecting the above ground storage with the below ground storage when the above ground storage is managed by public agencies and the underground storage is owned by private entities?
Well, panel one tried to deal with property rights and groundwater, and I was kind of hoping they'd resolve that so that I didn't have to opine. And I guess later on in this panel discussion, I can talk a little bit more about how I see Chapter 8 of Proposition 1 and the Water Commission's $2.7 billion helping with this solution, and some of the challenges are, but specific to this question, I think it's important to recognize that our surface water in this state is, for all intents and purposes, regulated by the State Water Resources Control Board, right? They issue licenses and permits and tell you when and how you can use that surface water and the accountability that you have. Groundwater rights are obtuse. I'm not an attorney, but when you look at four or five pages of a legal analysis that use terms like overlying rights, correlative rights, prescriptive rights, appropriative rights to try to define what groundwater is in terms of a property right, and then you also recognize that generally the existence or the definition of a groundwater property right has ultimately come out through a court decision. And almost every instance of adjudications in this state, it's been a judge who's decided what the groundwater right really is, or how he's at least going to dispose of the fight over that right. So we have kind of this real weird thing where growers are asserting that they have this property right. I would say that they are regularly asserted, they are commonly misunderstood, and we can only look to the courts often to try to help define what that is. And so that disconnect creates the challenge for us. Is it possible to connect the two by law? Well, SGMA specifically said we weren't going to. SGMA said we were going to respect surface water rights and any groundwater rights that exist in the implementation of the law. Can we regulate it? Maybe. State Water Resources Control Board has in the past attempted to try to take over regulatory control of groundwater, and frankly, that's one of the reasons why SGMA was drafted and implemented, was that was a defense against some appetites in the State Water Resources Control Board to kind of incorporate the two. I would suggest that the connectivity comes at the local level through our application and implementation of the law. The SGMA said specifically that local agencies have this responsibility. Now they can renege on that responsibility or waive that responsibility and let the regulators come in and take over. And I don't think any of us believe that that will be a more pleasurable solution than us trying to come up with this locally. But I think as we pursue this connection, and we've seen examples of this, I think you heard Ashley talk a little bit about how cities have started to wake up and understand what this looks like. In order to create the connectivity, I think the GSAs, the groundwater sustainability agencies that are forming, have to recognize what SGMA intended, and that was full-blown, robust stakeholder involvement. It's not the good old days for us water agency managers of publishing a publishing a notice that we're going to adopt a groundwater management plan, and then in a board action, move second and pass a plan and put it on the shelf. Stakeholder engagement in SGMA means you bring the pumpers, you bring the communities, the cities, you bring the environmental interests, the planners into a conversation about how are we going to conjunctively manage groundwater and surface water, create that connection, that controlled connection, so that we can achieve sustainability and advance the objectives or the economic platform that comes out of sustainable groundwater. So, you know, the challenge before us, and I don't think anybody's really fully appreciated this yet, is to figure out how to really engage the pumping community to come in and tell us what they need for solutions. Secondly, you've heard through the last three panels this concept of incentives, and I think the connection of surface water and groundwater can come through incentives to growers who have a great deal of assets. They have land, they have the property right in the groundwater, don't really necessarily have to define it if you can just work with them to create incentives to do things. We've talked a lot about this in terms of importation of surface water, utilization of floodwater for recharge, banking. We've seen just in the last few weeks or months some pretty incredible activities at the local level where water districts and growers are partnering up to take what historically was nuisance floodwater, and the historical pattern for flood management is let's get it out of the basin as fast as we can so we don't create damage. And now the new paradigm is let's figure out how we can get it back into the ground. Every one of our groundwater recharge facilities in this valley are full right now, full recharge capacity right now. So the challenge has been, and some have stepped up, to bring the grower community in and use on-farm, what I call on-farm floodwater utilization. Sustainable conservation has worked on that. Some of the districts are already and working with growers to dedicate property, to take floodwater, to put it in the ground, and guess what? Negotiating a credit for a piece of that groundwater so that that grower has that in the bank to use somewhere in the future. I think there are some, and my last point is, I think there are some challenges ahead of us in those areas. The platforms that are necessary for the accounting of those credits are critical. There are land management challenges, which you've heard about. We need to engage the resource management agencies, fish and wildlife at the state and federal level, to help us define and create visions for how we're going to manage properties that are going to be dual purposed for recharge, for management, and as part of the sustainability solution. And I'll stop there.
Thank you. Emmy, you're on the ground at a farm, and you've heard some of the suggested solutions for farm operations, like perhaps some setting some ground aside for environmental purposes and everything. And obviously you have had some experience then through some of the conservation agencies that you've worked with that have been exposed to this. But how do you do it, or how would you suggest it be done using your farm as an example? How can you diversify enough and yet remain viable when you're no longer in the more intense crop production activity?
Well, I think in terms of converting land to habitat, ideally we're converting the less productive land to habitat. The fiscal incentives play an important role in that, and I think we've, public funding from both the state and federal level is important. We actually, over 10 years ago, we and some of our business partners took a piece of ground that was not very productive for farming. We worked with the Natural Resources Conservation Service and put a wetlands reserve program easement on that land, and it's now bird habitat. So I think there are other programs that the Natural Resources Conservation Service administers the Conservation Reserve Program is another one. Hopefully we'll see some good funding in the next farm bill to support those programs. I think the other piece of the puzzle that's really important on the fiscal side, though, is the water itself. So we need to get to a place, and Stuart referred to this in terms of solar, and I think it applies to habitat as well. Water rights need to be treated more as a private property right. So historically, we've had our districts holding these, you know, surface water rights in trust for us, and you know, groundwater pumping was not restricted. We're now moving into a situation of shortage, and the individual growers are going to have to make hard decisions about whether or not to fallow land and what to grow, and they're the only ones that really have the ability to make those decisions. And so we need to be able to, if we convert to habitat, we convert to solar, we need to be able to sell those water rights, and that helps that conversion pencil out. You know, otherwise we're not going to be able to come up with enough public money to really make it work. Similarly, we need to work with our irrigation districts, remind them that they represent us as landowners, not themselves as bureaucrats, and you know, really treat even our surface allocations as a private property right that we can trade across district boundaries within the same basin, that, you know, pumping rights as well. We're going to get to a point where there are limited pumping rights, and we need to be able to trade those so that water is not trapped in water-rich areas with poor growing conditions. Leaving productive land to be fallowed, but can really move to where it can be used best economically, and that will really minimize the economic impact that Sigma has on the valley.
Okay, more of a market approach to water management, bringing that into the equation so that we have some flexibility that way to move from people who can sell it and use that for their income rather than a poor crop and a poor piece of ground. Well, okay. Randy, I'm going to come back to you. You asked for an opportunity to do a freewheel a little bit here. So what advice do you have for us in terms of stress in the valley, water stress? What do you see in the future that we need to do, and how do we communicate that at all levels to see that we are in a condition in the future where we're sustainable? So give us some of your thoughts based on your experience with the Stewardship Council and the efforts that you've been involved in thus far. I mean, how do we get where we need to go?
Well, that's a hard question. The Delta Stewardship Council was created in 2009 with the understanding that of the 200-plus local, state, and federal agencies that had some degree of regulatory or authority or responsibility for managing water and the environment in the Delta and beyond, they needed somebody to help coordinate their activities because they tended to be pretty siloed in their responsibilities and approaches. So I have, for 7 years, served on a Delta Stewardship Council whose primary responsibility is to identify problems and then to define those problems in a way that leads to identifying which agencies, local, state, and federal, have within their powers and responsibilities the authority to do something about it. Then working with them to figure out what is the proper approach. Once the proper approach is defined, then establish some performance measures so that as time goes on and a project or a plan or an action is implemented, we can determine whether the actions are really working or not. And then finally, monitor the activities, collect data, assess, and make changes. It's called adaptive management. State law requires that the work we do be driven by best available science and to be adaptively managed. So those are all the components to effectively dealing with the kinds of challenges that we have. And it occurred to me as I was preparing for this that the actions that will be taken and have been taken lend themselves well to this problem definition all the way unto adaptively management. What isn't subject to that are government regulations. Oftentimes we have a regulation, we've forgotten what the problem was that it was trying to solve. And some people have hinted at that in previous panels. I think it may be time to address, and I'm not going to pick any particular one regulation, but there are a number of them that have been around for a long time, and best available science will tell us they're not achieving what they were intended to achieve. The Delta plan that we developed, that consists of 73 recommendations, 14 regulatory policies, we are required to revisit that and to review it every 5 years to determine if it is effective. I think maybe we ought to apply the same thing to state and federal regulations.
Very good. I like that idea. So you see the template, though, that you've used in the Delta has perhaps some utility in addressing the issues in the San Joaquin Valley, but you would put the regulatory review as perhaps as one of the items on that laundry list as well.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'll give you an example of something we've learned from our work in the Delta. There is the need to convert land for habitat. And in order to do that, we set aside 6 high priority restoration areas. And in regulation, we prohibit any further activity in those areas that would compromise those abilities to achieve the kinds of habitat restoration that may come in the future. SGMA has a significant need to identify areas within the state where groundwater recharge can occur and where water can be stored, surface water and conveyance to those groundwater recharge areas. One of the recommendations that the Stewardship Council is now working on, it's called conveyance storage and operations, and we are promoting options for conveyance storage and operations throughout the state. One of the things that we're recommending is that the Department of Water Resources develop a model ordinance that can be provided to cities and counties that will can be incorporated into their planning and zoning ordinances to help protect those areas that we now know would lend themselves to groundwater recharge, but could easily get paved over in the future if they're not protected. So a lesson learned from the work that we've done in the Delta that can be applied throughout the state.
Well, there was already a bill a number of years ago that said the county general plans and the city plans had to map and locate the recharge areas, but I don't think it went all the way to the step to protect them. So that is an ongoing issue. Actually, you just heard a very interesting concept, and that is using the Stewardship Council model is kind of a template for how do we address the entire valley. But I know you've had experience with the partnership for the San Joaquin Valley. How do we leap from something that we've tried to work with through the partnership to something that the Stewardship Council is in terms of water? What are the institutional changes and things that we need to do maybe to get the whole valley working together?
Well, let me go at that in a couple different ways. And first of all, just kind of jumping off of something that Randy said, I think, and I usually get credit in any given room for stating the obvious. So let me please do that now, because I would like to complete my record of always being that person. So what I observe and experience when I think about, okay, what is the path forward for this very complicated region in this very complicated state in this really, really complicated regulatory environment? And by the way, having sat in a number of similar sessions over the years with many of you prior to being mayor, did 10 years in community and economic development, and obviously this conversation has been happening for a long time in this region. And what I observe is just the, literally you cannot have but a 2 or 3 minute stream of consciousness or thought before you start tensing up around all the constraints that exist to actually solve the problem. And so for a generation now or more, those of you that have been at this, trying to find the path, there really is just sort of this culture of it cannot be done. For obvious reasons, based on the constraints we have, it can't be done. So my feeling, and I think, Randy, part of what you're suggesting is if we could find a place and a table where the right people and, you know, all of the technical experts and that sort of thing could have some freedom to sit at that table and envision what the technical solutions are. Right, the co-equal goals, like how, like technically, how would it work? Never mind that. Oh, that'll never happen. Never mind that. So and so's already got a lawsuit on. Don't, like, stop that. There's no way we can solve this problem if the first thing we do is identify the constraints. It's too hard. The only chance we have, in my opinion, is if we actually gave ourselves freedom and permission to act like none of those constraints existed, and we actually see if there isn't an elegant solution, major components of which we look at and go, holy cow, we might actually be able to get that done and that done and that done, and then go back at it. And that, when you get to that point where it's the elegant solution that actually can't happen in the real world, but everyone agrees, like, yep, there it is, then you have a chance to really bring together a broad coalition throughout the region that maybe has a chance of producing the sort of regulatory changes and approaches that might actually just work in implementing that elegant solution. So when I was at City Hall, that's always how we approached really, really tough stuff. We acted like those constraints weren't there. We looked to see if we could find the path, and then we worked backwards from there to deal with the constraints. So, you know, again, thank you for letting me state the obvious. I feel better now. And you know, certainly at the Central Valley Community Foundation, we've been involved for the last 3 years in some Bechtel Foundation funded work in engaging the nonprofits in the drought impacted parts of our region, trying to strengthen those nonprofits and the service delivery and the, you know, the heavy burden that they have shouldered to try to support the region through the drought. We're just coming up on another grant cycle with Bechtel, and we're a part of a coalition of 5 community foundations around the state that are taking on this work together. And we're asking ourselves, before we just do kind of a status quo, we do the same old stuff, like, hold on, how could we partner differently on this? Can we talk to the state board? Can we do this? Can we do that? Particularly as it relates to the smaller outlying areas, which I know is part of your question as well, is like, what do we do with the, you know, with places that are really disconnected from major urban water systems? And we're hopeful with that sort of approach that we might just jar loose a piece of the solution that we haven't seen before. So we're looking forward to taking that on at the Community Foundation.
Well, thank you for that. Dave, that also introduces this concept at your level in the California Water Commission. Your short-term duty is really to figure out how to deal with the Proposition 1 bond, but where do you see the commission going in the future in addressing some of the water problems of the state, and especially the San Joaquin Valley? How can that conversation get started there, where it assists with the challenges that we're talking about and some of the solutions?
The good question. The commission is kind of this obscure entity that prior to the passage of Prop 1 and the water bond in 2014, really had this statutory defined role of assisting the Department of Water Resources in the oversight of the operation of the state water project, and also to review any regulations that the legislature had directed the California Department of Water Resources to create. Well, there weren't a whole lot of regulations, so the commission met from time to time. The big thing for the Water Commission was what they called Tin Cup Week. They would gather up and go back to Washington, D.C. and seek appropriations to support California investment in water infrastructure. And then that all changed in 2014 when the water bond was passed, because it gave us this checkbook, $2.7 billion to invest in storage. People ask me, well, who gets to make the final decision? The Water Commission gets to make the final decision. You know, Commissioner Herrera, who you heard from earlier, and I and 7 of other members of the commission appointed by the governor are going to make decisions probably in early 2018 on where we want to invest that money. There's no legislation involved. There might be a phone call from the governor, since we're all appointed, but you know, the commission has this duty, and it's been clearly defined in the statute and in subsequent regulations how we're going to make the decisions. But in the course of deliberating and creating those regulations and getting to that decision-making process, that's coming before us, we've started to recognize that we have kind of an interesting role now. We are a forum for the public to come in and talk to us about water management issues and water management challenges, because everything's knitted together. I often talk about the ball of string, and you can pull one end of the string, the ball of string, and think that you're going to make some advance, and what you do is start letting other parts of that ball of string fray out, because everything's connected. And the commission, I think, has an opportunity to have conversations about with the public about how some of these issues and challenges are going to move forward. When we get to temperance, and you mentioned temperance earlier, and if you live in the San Joaquin Valley, you know that, you know, we've a lot of us, you, whoever, have invested in this notion that temperance flat is the solution to our future. We need to build a very large storage facility on the San Joaquin River. That clearly, if we look at how the San Joaquin is flowing today, if we had storage there, we could be doing a lot better job in managing that supply for the next drought. But what the commission has started to promote is thinking beyond just a surface storage facility. Chapter 8 of Prop 1 allows us to look at things like temperance, but also challenges applicants to bring to us reservoir reoperation proposals, groundwater recharge proposals, local storage proposals, and we're starting to use the word integration. We've said to the public, we want you to bring to us integrated solutions that have multiple benefits. The statute only allows us to fund the public benefit of a project, which are, you know, ecosystem, water quality, recreation, navigation or flood control, and emergency response. So there's a whole nother water user, water delivery component that you know, the project proponents get to figure out how to pay for. But from a commission perspective, we want to make investments, I think, and this now I'm going to put just my personal editorial hat on, I think on regional strategies that move the ball forward in multiple ways, and not get locked into a very narrow conversation about, is temperance better than sites? Or is sites better than, you know, recharge in the Tulare Lake Basin, right? Or is Tulare Lake Basin better than something at Sacramento Regional that involves a reuse? We'd like to see integrated conversations with the commission about multiple part investments that deal with drinking water quality, that deal with flood control, that deal with storage that's essential, an essential part of sustainable groundwater management in the future.
Very good, thank you. Well, I mean, I'm gonna come back to you a little bit and ask you kind of a tough one as well. And that is the role of the agriculture in the future in terms of this kind of this integration strategy and the template for moving forward, put forward by Randy and used by the Delta Stewardship Council. Eric talked earlier today about a little bit of a conflict that happened in Kern County when the Board of Supervisors, who have responsibility for the so-called white areas, stepped up and said, by the way, our number one priority is land use planning, and don't get in my way. How do you see agriculture moving forward in this environment, whether it's SGMA or surface water supplies and improving viability for imports from the Delta? How do you see agriculture developing the proper roles and strategies to represent itself in these efforts? What do we need to do to make sure not only have a seat at the table, because a lot of the decisions are made often quite high up, but to make sure that the other people who are at the table understand your position, but then you also respect their position. So agriculture has a higher duty now, and how do we get there?
Well, I think our irrigation districts, are an important tool, and we need to get more involved in our irrigation districts. We need to elect boards that will represent the interests of the growers more directly. And I think we also need to work together with the other stakeholders and think about land use in the valley. There will be some land that's fallowed. I do believe that the individual landowner has to make the ultimate decision to fallow their land. But we, you know, work together with other stakeholders in the valley in terms of planning where, you know, where habitat can go, and really think about, you know, wildlife corridors, areas that have, you know, the potential to be really good habitat. And then what kinds of incentives can we give to those farmers to retire that land and help them move their operations elsewhere. I think we need to work with other stakeholders that have say recycled water. So for example, in Kern County, there's produced water from the oil fields. I know there's been some concern about the quality of that water, and that's very important. We need to make sure it's tested and make sure that it's good quality water, but that is water that we can be using. And then we need to make sure that as we, you know, I talked before about water marketing, and I do think that that, you know, the individual landowner needs to have an opportunity to decide what to do with their water resource. At the same time, a water market needs to take into account the local communities of, you know, people who are employed in agriculture, the other businesses that depend on agriculture, and make sure that we continue to have vibrant, you know, vibrant economies that are the support economies. And then the other thing I would point to, we've talked a lot today about groundwater recharge. I think farmers can play a big role in that in the form of on-farm recharge. And again, we need to figure out the right way to compensate those farmers. Historically, our dedicated recharge basins are groundwater banks, and we have a lot of them in Kern County. They develop a bank account, essentially, that then they can pump that water and sell that water. I think we need to be looking at how we can do that with individual farmers to really give them an incentive to bank water instead of like where our farm is. There are some farmers that have put up berms, and flood water is just flowing past them and flooding one of the small communities in the valley. If we gave them the right incentives, a lot of that ground is fallow right now because of it's winter time, and they'd be recharging that water, and everyone would be better off.
Okay, well, I'm going to follow that up with you a little bit, and I'm going to ask the same question, or I'm going to pose it so that it goes to everybody. I'm really kind of talking a little bit about a succession. You talk about getting people in the irrigation districts involved, so you're talking about the board of directors and the manager, and do they have the capacity, and do you see, or what will it take to make sure that the people that get in those positions understand the necessity of all the things that we've talked about today of moving forward and how they integrate into the overall system. My experience in irrigation districts, and I'm a former general manager, is that our primary duty was to our customers and our farmers and our operators in the land, and it was very difficult to spend much time to worry about all the exterior things. There were other organizations that kind of assumed that responsibility. But what we've heard today for the most part is that we really need to get down to the farm level and get each individual person engaged to some degree. Dave mentioned it about you've got to engage the individual farmer if you're going to use his land for storage. So it's going to require much more intensive involvement. Do you see the people coming up, or what do we need to do to make sure that we do have the right people in the right places to move this thing forward? And I'll ask that question of all of you. Where do we go in terms of the people issues?
Well, there's clearly a capacity issue if we depend only on one sector, right? I mean, even the best staffed water district in the valley, which probably is Westlands, doesn't have the capacity to implement SGMA in a way that that will minimize the impact of allocation of an overdraft to the lands within the district, right? I mean, the simple solution is you come out, you say, I've got half an acre foot per acre, you all get a piece, and we're going to set up a meter system and account for it, and we're done. But that's not what SGMA intended. SGMA intended, and I said this earlier, that we leverage a combination of interests and sectors into a conversation. And again, I mentioned earlier, sitting in the governor's horseshoe and negotiating SGMA for what seemed like 122 years, We talked a lot about local agency management of the water supply, but I was sitting there thinking, wow, in the Kings, we've got this thing nailed. We've had the Kings River Integrated Regional Water Management Plan in place for over 10 years. We're all talking together. It's going to be great. We'll just come down and add one more piece to the IRWM. We had the cities involved. We had the disadvantaged communities involved. It wasn't perfect, but there was a great dialogue going on a pretty regular basis. And when Sigma hit the street, everybody scurried to their corners and went back to their old way of doing things. And the IRWM kind of went into, didn't free fall, but it got pretty close to crashing because things got very parochial at that point. It was no longer about coming together for money. It was about splitting apart and protecting their share of the asset. But we have to get back there. And I think Sigma demands that we bring the grower community into a conversation with the planners, with the communities, with the disadvantaged communities, with the public at large about what do we want this groundwater basin to look like. And it's going to be real hard for some. For some, you know, the overdraft is manageable and it can be dealt with by flood water utilization and water use efficiency. In others, it's going to be a very hard decision about which lands do we retire. And it's a big number. It is, Ellen mentioned 500,000 acres. I would say here that it's probably close to twice that. Yeah. If you look at the per acre use of groundwater, the lands that are going to come out, it's a big, big number. And we need to have conversations with planners and with growers and others on how best to implement that.
So I would love to chime in from a city perspective, and you know, cities actually have a requirement by state law to update their general plans. They're supposed to do it every 5 years, cities and counties. And so cities are actually pretty good at knowing how to do this community engagement, that sort of thing. Historically on the valley floor, usually it's just kind of one industry that shows up and says, well, this is where I have land, and therefore I need you to plan for this so that I can develop my property a certain way. But in the city of Fresno, for example, when we updated our general plan, which was adopted in 2014, our 2035 general plan, we did really intentional outreach. We spent 3 years engaging the residents of Fresno, stakeholders, et cetera, in addition to the building industry, which obviously they were a big part of it as well, but they weren't the only voice. And it was a really intense, aggressive community outreach process that resulted in what some would say is probably one of the most aggressive and innovative land use plans and policy documents on the valley floor that they've really ever seen. We backed that up with rewriting our development code to make it easy to implement the plan, because we didn't want to just pass a law that then you couldn't implement because the regulations were out of sync with it. And then we rezoned the city to be consistent with that policy and the regulations. So now it's all very streamlined. The only reason why the city of Fresno was able to move in that direction, the only reason why, was because we had enough people from the ag sector showing up and expressing a voice. And on the night when the council voted and selected the alternative that was studied, went through the full and complete environmental review, and it was the most focused on infill, protecting our boundaries, included language about farmland preservation, you know, identifying our connection to this major ag economy that's all around us. The only reason why that got passed on a 5-2 vote, we had plenty of people from low-income neighborhoods who were there saying in various languages, English, Spanish, Hmong, et cetera, enough is enough. We want to focus on our disadvantaged neighborhoods. This hasn't happened in our city. We demand something different. But you know what? That voice alone would not have carried the vote of the Fresno City Council. The only reason why we got it passed was because that voice from the low-income community was coupled with big ag interests who showed up and said, can you please stop messing with with our worlds? Can you please stop taking our farmland? Can you please do something about what you're doing with the groundwater? So the combination of that business interest coupled with the low-income community coming together produced a supermajority vote for that alternative, which then ultimately was adopted with 5 votes as well. So it was only a handful of you guys who showed up and engaged in that conversation. And I know this is feeling like yet another thing that you need to come to and help provide leadership on, et cetera, and you have your hands full. But let me just encourage you let me just say one more quick thing. In the elected official world, what I've noticed is that city people talk to builders, and then state elected officials and Congress people talk to farmers. And city people don't talk to farmers, and Congress people don't talk to city people. So that has to stop. Those walls have to come down. And so please consider that your cities, your communities, are major partners in this future that we all share together, and you ought to be finding a way to plug in, which is already a pretty robust and well-defined process for public participation. You can make the difference in your local communities.
Randy, you get last word, and then we're done. We'll open it up for questions. What do you think about this gap between the high level that we're talking about in terms of how to move forward and the lowest common denominator, somebody out there and a ranch who probably can't make it to a meeting? You might run into him in the coffee shop, but we've got to communicate better.
Well, we have a local example in the in my area in Turlock. The State Water Resources Control Board is updating the Delta Water Quality Control Plan, and they have phased their approach to updating the plan. Phase zero is the upper San Joaquin. I guess they figured they had enough problems with the San Joaquin River restoration that they'd get a pass. So phase one is the Merced, the Tuolumne, and the Stanislaus Rivers. And the state board has determined that in order to improve water quality conditions in the Delta, that there needs to be a significant increase in the amount of water dedicated to in-stream flows on those three tributaries. Well, the local agencies ginned up a lot of local action. If you go to Modesto, you see signs all over. It says, save the stand. If you're in the Turlock area, it's worth your fight. And in the Merced area, that's an acronym, SAFE, that represents their approach. But in all three cases, they've got the public all fired up, but the public doesn't know what the issue is. They know that something evil is happening that's coming at them from the state. The evil state regulators are going to take their water. The responsibility of the irrigation districts and the leaders is to help, one, define the problem, and then, two, craft solutions. The state board, and at the direction of the governor, is hopefully going to be entertaining a settlement offer prepared by representatives of these three tributaries that will go beyond flow. It'll recognize that we need a more natural, functional flow in these rivers, but we also need to address predation, we need to address stream bed restoration in the spawning areas, we need to address invasive species, invasive aquatic weeds. There's a whole host of stressors on the system that if they are not addressed, simply adding more water in these narrow channels is not going to help. It's incumbent upon the water leaders to explain to the locals what the solutions are. And that way, you help combine the growers and the community behind the solution, and not focused on the evil state empire that, and they don't really know why they're against it, but they are.
Thank you very much. That concludes the panel presentation, ladies and gentlemen. Thank them. And now we're ready to take questions from the audience. All the way in the back, Sarah Camp. Just got the.
Okay. Hi, I'm Sarah Campy. I work for the Sierra Nevada Conservancy. We're also a state agency. I guess this question is directed to Mr. Orth, although I'm open to anyone responding. In your conversation about storage options, I felt like one of the things you neglected to mention was the upper watershed, that through Assembly Bill 2480, the state recognized the importance of source watersheds as California's water infrastructure. There's also some good work coming out of UC Merced, for example, looking at forest thinning or forest management and snowpack retention. And I'm wondering, A, what you think about that, and B, how can we get these federal land management agencies and upper watershed stakeholders engaged in the SGMA conversation?
There's no question that watershed management can play a big part of a reliable, sustainable solution for the valley. And I think Chapter 8 of Prop 1, unfortunately, doesn't explicitly recognize that. Again, some of the commissioners have talked about, and the commission generally have talked about, when we talk about integrated solutions, it was not an intentional omission. It was an error on my part to acknowledge that watersheds should be part of that. But the statutory language is pretty narrow. We cannot invest in watershed management strategies that aren't related to a storage facility, because the statute's very clear in defining the types of projects that are eligible, and watershed management is not one of those. So the trick here, and it's just like groundwater projects meeting the public benefit component of Chapter 8, is the trick is to get pretty creative and bring integrated solutions that have multiple parts into the commission. I think in terms of engagement, there's two venues. One is as projects are being vetted, and unfortunately we are on a very, very short and aggressive time frame. I think by July of this year, you know, we've got an application deadline. So reaching out to and engaging the local project development community, whoever they are. We know the San Joaquin Valley Water Infrastructure Authority is meeting right now to talk about their package proposal to the commission. Engaging with them and seeking a watershed component into their strategy is a good idea. The other would be to come in and talk with your local GSAs in the valley and explain how watershed management can assist them in meeting their sustainability goals.
More questions? I think we wore everybody out. Here's one.
My name is Andy Gorders with the California Department of Fish and Wildlife Fresno. And Sarge mentioned Mariposa County, which triggered a thought and question in my mind. Two-thirds of California's water supply originates in the Cascade and Sierra Mountains. I live in a mountain community, and over the years I've seen septic systems leach into our waterways, overgrazing, serious erosion on our roads, driveways, and building pads. And everybody's aware that sediments eventually end up in our reservoirs. It decreases water capacity as well as nutrient loading and decreases water quality. So my question is, how can the communities in the valley, the coast, Southern California connect with these mountain communities to educate the owners of these watershed properties and also provide financial incentives for them to better manage these watersheds?
I think Dave kind of answered that question. I think that engagement is necessary, bringing the upper watershed areas into the overall planning process. Dave, isn't that what you're really suggesting? Is it's a multitude of problems. It's not just forest health or whatever.
Yeah, again, that the integrated regional water management strategies that were in place prior to SGMA, and I alluded to this earlier, really promoted, and we're starting to create venues and forums where you could reach even further into the watershed, into conversations. And unfortunately, I think SGMA has kind of pulled us back. I predict it may take 5 years, possibly 10, that all these GSAs are going to be sitting around looking at each other and thinking about how much money they're spending and thinking, why didn't we do it through the IRWM? And they'll start morphing into a regional governance structure again. And those are the places where I think watershed-based strategies, you heard this earlier in an earlier panel, are where those broader discussions can take place.
I just add to that. So I sit on an advisory panel for the Nature Conservancy, and they're doing some pretty innovative work around that with bonds that would, and it's still early in the process, but the first step is to try and measure what the impacts are of conserving and better management of some of those upper watersheds, and then can you get measurable impacts on downstream water and prove that was the source. And if they're successful in doing that, then that's a way to financially tie the upper watershed restoration with those with the value of that water downstream.
Yeah, Daniel Mountjoy with Sustainable Conservation. Wanted to come back to the federal partnership question. We heard Stuart Wolf talk about the cost of water for delivery on the west side. Dave, you mentioned reoperation of reservoirs. And with the Corps flood curve calculations being really a federal policy, what options or to what degree can we bring the federal agencies to the table in this kind of discussion to solve California's water management problem, since they do have a large role in our water management?
Maybe I'll start. Again, one of the responsibilities at the Stewardship Council is to help coordinate state, federal, and local agencies. We have created a Delta Plan Interagency Implementation Committee, DPIC for short, and it consists of 17 state and federal agencies. So we have the federal water agencies, the federal fish agencies, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, USGS representing federal science, at the table meeting every 6 months. And we've been real careful about establishing an agenda that leads to an acknowledgement around the table of actions to move forward on. The feds are there voluntarily. The state agencies are there because state statute says they have to be. So that is a forum every 6 months to revisit issues. I'll tell you one thing that may come up. There was recently a letter from the National Marine Fisheries Service to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission about how the response at Oroville should be conducted in a fish-friendly way. And there are many people that think that whoever submitted that letter was a little bit out of touch with reality and the fact that the state is responding to a major, could have been a major catastrophe. Lots of emergency reactions are underway, and we will probably be discussing that in April when the group convenes about how to better connect the federal agencies with the reality of the problems that we're dealing with in California.
I'll just mention real quick on the reservoir reoperation question relative to Corps of Engineer flood curves. There is federal legislation that's been enacted recently that directs the Corps nationally to look at their flood management curves and strategies in those reservoirs if supported by the local project sponsors. So the local project sponsors have to decide that reservoir reoperation is something that they want to explore. And then I think the Corps will willingly engage in that conversation because there's a congressional, you know, policy direction to do so. But the locals struggle with the issue because right now if we reoperate a reservoir and dump water that otherwise we know would be in a surface water facility and we try to get it into the ground, we don't have great knowledge of what happens to the water after it gets into the ground. And, you know, Emily knows that she can get an acre foot per acre out of a federal or local surface storage facility, but once it gets put into the ground under her neighbors can pump it all out. So there's a key set of operational rules and guidelines that have to be constructed locally, and then I think the Corps would engage as a willing partner.
So I'm Ellen, and trust me with the closing remarks here. So first, I want to thank everybody for coming, and particularly our panels. I think one thing to take away is that there's a lot of expertise here in the Valley, and so you can share that with anybody that wants to talk about water and what our challenges are. We do have experts here, and I'm very encouraged that they'll find a path forward. Second, there will be a survey sent to you this afternoon, right, by email, and it's really, really important to future events to understand what we're doing right and perhaps what we could do better and maybe what things you'd like to see going down the road. And finally, I do want to thank the PPIC the opportunity of partnering with Fresno State. We think this is a good partnership, and we certainly would like to continue that in the future, and we hope to see many, many more events here in the Valley. Thank you.